philanthropist, part evangelist for so many causes in our city and our town. After watching John's famous Grunion dance, one reporter described him as a combination of Santa Claus and Pee Wee Herman. Creative, I suppose. But I think we can do better. We must do better than that. As I thought about all the themes in John's life, an awe-filled love of nature, a joy-filled love of children, a faith-filled love of God, a tear-filled love of those who are suffering in some way, I couldn't help but think of St. Irenaeus, a profound second century bishop who reshaped our whole faith around the theme of love. That bishop once said that the glory of God is a human, fully alive. And if I had to describe John Olguin in one phrase, that would be it: a human, fully alive. And there are at least four ways he showed it. He was alive to the work of God in nature. Every whale-watch trip seemed like his first, when he'd already done 20 or 30 of them in that year. He'd make that clicking sound whales used to communicate. He'd compare them to the size of the boat in which you were riding. He'd talk about their mighty tails. On land, he described the gunion or the starfish and the funny way they moved. But he wouldn't just let you sit there. He'd make you imitate. Do it, do it, do it. He'd make you get involved. And that involvement made this time exciting. John was alive to the work of God in nature. And he helped us come alive as well. He was also alive to the love of God for children. Just as Jesus once said, "Let the children come unto me." So John drew children. They came to him like metal shavings to a magnet. Councilwoman Hahn recently said John Olguin was everyone's granddad. And in some sense, he was. So many worthy projects started with his love of children. From the mayonnaise jar museum that became our local aquarium, the burned fingers he wished to prevent by hosting a safe and festive 4th of July gathering near the harbor. John always wanted to make life better for our children. And he did. Third, he was alive to the grace of God in Jesus Christ. He often told me about the time he was listening to Billy Graham on the radio while wrestling with his own level of commitment to Christ and to Christ Church. Life was so busy for this very dramatic man. Where could he find time for faith? Dr. Graham said there would come a time when you needed God's full commitment to your problems. You better be prepared to make a full commitment in response. Within days of hearing that message, John saw his young daughter, Monica, slipping off the cliffs over by Point. And John said, "God, this is my time." Being a lifeguard, he knew that her odds were so very slim. But he found her on a little ledge just beyond the cliff. Pulled her up to safety again. God had given John a miracle in the survival of his daughter. And he spent the rest of his life giving thanks. So he's alive to the work of God in nature, the love of God in children, the grace of God in Jesus. And even more than that, more than all of that, John was alive to the call of God in service. The fourth passage we read today is known as the Good Samaritan. I've preached the text many times. But I've never met a person who lived the text the way that our John did. He was the Good Samaritan to scores of needy people each year. There was always one more family who needed food at Thanksgiving. Even when our church's supplies were gone, John got it to them. There was always one more soul who wanted to come to worship or senior lunch, but no transportation was available. John got them here. There was always one dear neighbor who was in crisis of some sort. And many of those crises were profound. No matter how dear he was, how broke he was, how busy he was, John did everything in his power to help. I'll never forget the time Kim Andrew and I went to a 4th of July celebration down at Rio Beach. John insisted we ride with him, and we enjoyed a lovely evening sitting right in front of the bandstand as the Golden State Pops played. While riding home from that event in our preferred parking spot, John noticed another family that was struggling to carry some very heavy burdens to their car, and so he stopped. They hadn't asked him to do it. He just did it. And he insisted on helping them, loading their supplies into his car, piling their children in the back in every other which way, and taking them to the spot far away in which they had to park. I hadn't even noticed the family when I was riding there. I said, "How did you see him?" John said, "It is my lifeguard's eye. I'm trained to surface that water, to scan it repeatedly and find people in need." And he did the same thing on land, over and over again. It's as if he saw the town in which we live through the eyes of Christ. And soon the heart of Christ was moving within him. More than anyone else I've ever known, John Olguin was a human, fully alive. The humbling part of knowing John is knowing that she'll never live up to that. Never. None of us will love and serve and act the way John did. But the great part of knowing John is that he invited us to participate. Do it. Whether we are taking children to see the Grunion, or sponsoring children in a well watch, or feeding families in a Thanksgiving basket drive, or raising funds to build our new wonderful aquarium, John invited us to participate. And we did. When we did, John touched us. Because we live, this town in which we live will never be the same. Thanks be to God for a man who made us come alive. Now here's some thoughtful words from John's family.
Hello. I'm Albert, John's brother, the one that nobody knows. So now you know. All my life, my brother John has always said to me, it's good to have a little brother. And I was his little brother till the very end. And now the mantle has been passed. My brother Roy, who was the oldest, is home with the Lord. My brother Gus is gone. My brother Alfonso is gone. My brother Leonard's not doing too well. My brother John is gone. I am the chief chumash. To my sisters, to my immediate family, I would like to say, all rise. That's it. I demand more. I told them they don't have to do that every time I come in the room, but it would be nice. Maybe just a bow of the heads or a little genuflex would be wonderful. I've been waiting 81 years for this seniority, and I don't know what to do with it. I don't collect anything, I don't go anywhere, I don't do anything. He did it all for me. My brother John had three loves in his life. The first one was the love of God and Jesus Christ. That was foremost in his whole life. He never put that aside. That's the way he lived, and that's the way he was. John was a giver, not a taker. He gave of himself to everyone that I know, to myself, to the family, when somebody was sick, when somebody was there, John was always there. John's second greatest love was his wife and his children. They were foremost. They were there. They were there for him when he needed them, and he was there for them when they needed him. John was a good father. He was a great provider. He was a good man. I don't know if anybody has ever said to me, are you John's brother? Everybody's always said to me, what's your name? Yes, I'm John's brother. And I always will be. And John's third love was San Pino and his family. Those two things were formal to his life. He was Mr. San Pedro. He was, you know, everybody said he was the, what did they call him? The citizen of the century?
Yes.
No. He was the Mexican of the millennium. If you don't believe that, you gotta watch him eat a burrito sometime. He loved San Pedro, he loved his family. He loved being who he was. He did not like shoes. Or sandals, so we once went to the football game one night and feet were purple. And I said, you know, you can't have my shoes, John, you know. I can't walk in yours and you can't have mine. John was a great guy. He was my brother, he'll always be my brother. And I'm just so proud, and always have been, to be the one that nobody knows, and John's little brother. Thank you very much.
Me to use my Indian name, tall, thin woman. I'm the baby of the family. I'll always be the baby. And my sister Esther, who's sitting over here, requested that I just share a few stories about John. So now I'll be Esther. When John and Muriel and Micah took a trip up there to see her in Lake Chelan area. Her little hick town is named Manson. It is folksy and beautiful, and this lake is 50 miles long, and it's about the third deepest lake in Washington. They brought their canoe, And they all paddled in the canoe, and we rented a speedboat. And they took off to going, the three of them, to the end. I can't even say the name, but it's Steak. And it was a windy day. But anyway, they did that, and we met with them and gave them food. They were up on a rock, and they were praying. That's a part of the story. But the fun part of the story is John said, my sister, when they did that, she called the radio, because it's a cute little town, and said, oh, my brother John is coming, and blah, 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 and they're in the canoe, and they said, oh, we would love to interview him. But you know what that means. The next thing you know, the next year, they had a John Olguin Day. And John met the lifeguard there and taught the kids things, and it was just, and they all had t-shirts and he signed them, and it was like he said, oh. But anyway, so that was Esther. And my humble words is, I loved all my brothers. And I miss them all. But since this is about John and it's not about me, I'll focus on John. John was a teacher. And he was a big brother, kind and loving. And what makes me so proud that you see all your people here. I was going to end this by saying that, no. I'm sorry. I should have asked my sister for more stories. You really don't need one. But also, take a look at this face. And remember, I'm John's sister.
I was just saying, I'm Oni, and this is the easy part for me. So I just want to share a couple of things that he personally told me. When my dad was running for honorary mayor about 20 years ago, he had buttons made, some of you may remember them, that said, love John. And you could look at that two ways. Love from John, because he was the man that was always giving, 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 or the command, love John. So he really got, the family got a big laugh out of that one. We talked about that for a long time. So love was a major theme of his life. First of all, my dad loved my mother. He loved his family, all his family. He loved his friends, and he loved this church. He loved San Pedro, and that's the short list. I'd like to share, too, three conversations I had with my dad that showed his love. A few years ago, I called him, because I called him a lot, complaining. Oh, my kids weren't doing what I wanted. My husband wasn't doing what I wanted. Life wasn't good. School wasn't good. And I thought he was going to say, oh, you poor little chiquita. Oh, that's too bad, Monica. But what he told me was, change your attitude. And I started laughing. It took me so by surprise. I just started laughing. Because he was right. And that was one of his gifts to me. And I used to tell him all the time for many years, I would tell him, oh, Dad, I'm going to miss you so much when you die. And he would tell me, he would say, hey, I lived through World War II. And I'm going to die an old man. And he said that to me so many times. And then, just a week ago, he was sitting on my couch. And I told him again how much I was going to miss him. He said, oh, don't worry about me. I'm going to be with Jesus. But I'm going to worry about you. my dad was positive. He was grateful. He was compassionate. And he was loving. The best in him lives on through us.
John Olguin, 1956. Great. His church. And is it all right if I give it to these guys? Thank you. And I was going through this book, and Monica, when you were in, how old were you when you had meningitis? 10? I remember this. She had cerebral meningitis, and we were going to lose her. And prayers is what brought her back. And she wrote, "A joyful day to be here." And I'm not even going to try and read it, but it was Monica, December 8th, 1961. I was in one of those little white outfits. I started off as a soprano and worked my way up to the altos. I loved sitting with the girls. I got to be in the madrigals with you guys. That was wonderful for me, singing. Yeah, to share a life like my father was just amazing. And he touched so many people and in so many communities, from the church community here. I couldn't do anything without him following me along when I was a Boy Scout. He was a Boy Scout leader. When I was in the church group here, he was a church group leader. So he was always involved in my life. He was a hard, well, I'm going to elaborate on your story that you stole. And that is the one about Monica falling off the cliff. Because he told me, and it was one of the stories you probably told everyone, you probably heard it 10 times before, but that he had a weakness in his faith, and he said out loud, "Lord, if you're out there, give me a sign." And it was that weekend that Monica fell off the cliff. And there was an overhang on the cliff where there was plants that were growing over the edge, and she fell through the plants to this ledge down below. And Jack Cheney, which was my mom and dad's best man, grabbed his ankles and lowered him over the edge of the cliff. And Monica was 3 or 4. You were 6? Anyway, she had a lot of good hair. That he was able to grab her hair and pull her over. So that was how I heard the same story. My daughters are in Europe right now. Molly is going to King's College in London on the Thames River. And one of her roommates had a friend visiting from the States. So she went on, "So, where are you from?" "Palos Verdes." "Oh, wow, I'm from San Pedro." So it says, "Do you know anyone?" And they had a childhood friend they went to Crestwood School together with, or knew from Crestwood. Carrillo Beach? "Yeah, my dad was a volunteer there." So someone that was in London, a couple weeks ago, got to meet John Olguin's granddaughter that far away. So everyone knows our dad, and I say this inclusively because he's our dad. He would have you up and dancing like a jellyfish. His infectious way of getting you to volunteer, you couldn't say no to our dad, the Pied Piper of Pedro. You wouldn't want to go on a winter fundraising whale watch trip, but how could you say no to buying a ticket to the Boys and Girls Club? Father knows best, and that he has touched us, we are the better for it. I love you, Dad. Thank you for this life.
Understand that John's grandson, Micah, would also like to say a few words.
Sorry, Micah. In the program, because I'm not sure I can do this. I'm going to try. Sorry. I never thought he would go. He was immortal. I remember, really, he was a Mexican Poseidon, I remember him on that trip to Lake Chelan, and we were in the canoe, and the wind came up, and there were waves, and he jumped on the balcony, and jumped down on the rocks, and heaved the canoe up with maybe 100 pounds of gear, myself and my grandmother. He was fearless, and this was in the 70s. I remember him with his brothers, with his chest puffed out, and played pool, and just like a little young man. I remember him arm wrestling my grandmother too. And it was a big deal in high school when I finally got him to a standstill. That was a big deal. So I never thought he would go. And last night I dreamt that I lost my leg. And I woke up and I realized immediately what that meant. This is a part that's so integral that you never think it's going to go. And that's what he was to all of us, to his community and to his friends and to his family. He was the legs we stood on. He was just an integral part of all of us. As a grandfather, he was amazing. He was loving. He was patient. He was fun. We could do anything we wanted to him. He had so much dignity. He had dignity to spare. My cousins, my little cousins, they dress them up, they put a wig on her. They put my grandmother's moon on. He didn't mind at all. He thought it was great. He smiled at both of them. And, I remember too, hiking with the family, and I didn't want any of this. I had my backpack was too heavy. My feet were sore, I was thirsty, I was hungry, I hated it. I whined all the way for about a mile. So they finally come up to me and say, "Hey, I'm going to teach you a little trick. This is what you used to do in the army. I'm going to come up and I'm going to carry your pack from behind. We're going to go real fast." She said, "Okay." I grabbed my pack and we jogged. We jogged and we were out of sight of the family and we sat down. He got a saltine. He loves saltines. And he got one, I got one. We took some water and we tried to eat the saltine in as many bites as we could. That was his thing. Take little tiny bites until we finish the saltine. And the minute the family came into view, he said, "Okay, your turn." So I picked up his pack and we ran. And we got in. I did that for 7 miles. And by the time I got there, my feet weren't sore. I wasn't thirsty. I wasn't hungry. I loved it. And that was a genius. He He was able to make him do what he wanted to do. And you ended up liking him. I'm really, really going to miss him. I know you are too. Oh boy. No, I forgot what I was going to say, sorry. But you know, he always used to tell us too that when he died, he didn't want us to be, sad. That's a big, big thing, but I'm trying. You want us to be happy. He said, I'm going to be with God, I'll be happy, and I'm going to be watching over you. And I think it's important that we remember that. This is the end of his journey, the end of an amazing journey, and we're here to celebrate his life. So we should really keep that in mind. Thank you.
Genes in that family. Now the family has prepared a video presentation for us to watch. And some of you up front want to join me sort of in the side aisle. We can probably catch it from an angle here.
He would go into the back room where he kept all his photos and come out with a tray full of slides and start playing. The funny part was, the slides were usually a mix of all kinds of different events, public, family, past, present, all just mixed together, which was part of the entertainment. So John, this slideshow is for you. John was a born leader. Oftentimes when my father Roy wasn't around, John was the man of the house, and we were to obey. Each of the boys had their own shoebox, and John would get the brothers and walk down to Harper Boulevard and shine shoes. And he had the bright idea of taking Albert along because he was so adorable, even though he shined the shoes on the soles. But he made a lot of money, and he brought every dime home to my mother. My mother was very proud of her sons, and of course, my sister and I. She worked very hard to keep the family together. She worked at the cannery to put food on the table and a roof over our heads.
Always love you and make you happy.
John always took care of us and made sure we were safe and had food on the table and smiles on our faces. I remember when I was 7 years old, gluing macaroni on a little cardboard that said John Olguin for student body president. After high school and the war broke out, my brother joined the army. And John faithfully wrote letters to my mom and my sister and I and promised that if we obeyed my mom, he would treat us to whatever we wanted at the thrifty drugstore, 9th and Pacific. Which John was a lifeguard, and we would go down to the beach, my sister and I, and my mother. He would have one eye on us and one eye on the public. And he would get on the horn and tell my mother, slow down, old lady, because she would swim to the ropes and back and have this unique stroke. She was adorable. And he kept watch over all of us at the beach. Everybody knew John was a lifeguard. But what they didn't know, that when the bus fare went up to 7 cents, he said, no way am I going to pay 7 cents. He had my sister and I walk him down 2-3 blocks to the wharf. We took his clothes, he jumped in, and he swam to work. And along the way, a porpoise would follow him. He had a love of the sea. My sister and I felt we owned the beach. John was the captain, and I had 4 brothers as lifeguards, Roy, Pancho, Albert, and Leonard. Oh boy, did we think we were hot stuff. Talk about hot stuff. When Muriel came into our lives, John knew her when they were 8, but they reconnected, and in comes this beautiful, tall, elegant young lady with dark, beautiful, long hair, blue eyes, and a laugh that just sent it to the moon. John would always say, you know you met the one when you can't live without him. And she was the one. They were inseparable. She supported him, and he supported her. It was a joy to see them. They held hands, they laughed together, they rode together. They were athletic, fun, loving, unique couple. They lived in San Pedro all of their lives. At one time, they lived at the lighthouse, and Viola was born there. It was such a beautiful place, right at Point Fermin Park. They had Viola, later came Monica, and finally his son, Johnny Cabrillo. I wonder what beach he was named after. When grandchildren came along, he was a fantastic grandpa. He would take them to the beach and make sand castles to die for. Children would gather around John. He'd say, oh, come on, you want to see a whale? And he would make this fabulous whale. John was actually an outsider. He worked outside as a lifeguard. He played outside, rowing the boat and watching the whales. He even slept outside for 53 years with Muriel. He was always thinking outside of the box. John put the fun in fundraising. As my brother Albert put it, he was a con artist in a very good way. He could con the socks off your feet without ever taking your shoes off. John was a great storyteller. He loved to tell everyone about Mother Nature and his love of the sea. When he would start talking about sea life, he would get so excited. He would start speaking in tongues. Whale tongues, that is. I sometimes wonder if I had a whale for a brother. Not only did he love whales, he loved donkeys. He was very patriotic. And when it came to politics, you knew what side he was on. New Year's Day, when John died, the pastor asked us to describe John in one adjective. And here are a few of the words. Thoughtful, energetic, loving, social, giving, family, stubborn. Noble. And he was very protective, athletic, strong, willful, healthy, a Christian, the love of life, stud muffin. Funny, courageous, naturalist, a small boat enthusiast. And he was a Papa Grunion. If I had to describe John in just one adjective, it would be doggedly determined. When we would gather in the house, he would say, you want to hear my dog leg gallop? And he would get the dog, come and sit on the piano. He would play the piano, the dog went. And we'd laugh and laugh. He was determined. doggedly determined. He was humble. Even the way he left this earth was humble and noble. Just like my sister said, he just walked out the back door and quietly checked out. If he knew all the fuss we were doing about his death, he would probably say, "Hey, why didn't you sell tickets and the proceeds?"
What a fabulous video. Thank you so much. Let us go to God in prayer. Dear Lord, we are so grateful for the man who beckoned us to the sunny side of the street. A man who carried our packs when they seemed a bit too heavy. A man who protected us from danger, and a man who touched us in countless ways. We thank you for his influence in our lives and in our world. And we thank you that his good deeds remain. From the blue lights on the bridge to the Fresnel lens at the lighthouse to the aquarium to countless other projects in our town, John's thumbprint is here. He will always be with us. And so, God, as we commend his soul to you, we thank you that his spirit, his love, his grace is still down here with us. And we pray, God, that you would enable us bring that love to others through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray by saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Our final reading for this service will be delivered by John's daughter, Vi. And understand this is one that he kept posted in the final months of his life.
You might know that my dad always had a little black book. Here it is. Yeah. So I was looking at it, trying to find telephone numbers to call, and look what I found. I want to read this to you as he carried it next to his heart. It's Psalm 146. "The happiness of those whose help is the Lord." You'll hear a lot of his themes in here. "Happy is he who has the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God, who made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, who keeps truth forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord gives freedom to prisoners. Praise the Lord." Anyway, I've been blessed, very blessed, to be so close to both my mother and my father. And and my family and my friends, and I really want to thank you for coming and supporting us all and for sharing the love of my Father. Thank you.
Church, I want to thank the family for your contribution to this service. We have known and loved your dad for many years, but some of us did not know how much fun the rest of you were. What a joy to share this day with you. I'm sure that many of you will want to speak with members of the family and swap some of your stories about our dear John at the gathering that's held immediately after the service in McDonald Hall. We're going to have a Crunch and Cookies gathering. There's a couple ways to get there. You can go out the door and up the steps. There's also a stairwell right here in the narthex on the way out after this service. And we hope that many of you can stay and continue our celebration then. But at this time, we are ready to conclude this service with a lively jazz number, When the Saints Go Marching In. I understand we actually have a trumpeter who has showed up. He hasn't rehearsed with Rob, so this could be an adventure. But both of them were game, and so why don't you stand and join me as they play.
Thank you.
John, even in heaven, I don't know if you can beat that. Go forth thou in peace, beloved serve the Lord. And as you go, may the God of peace, who brought back our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead, make you complete in everything good, working among us that which is pleasing in his sight, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you would please let the family exit first. Upstairs, you can join them now.